Marriage and Meditation Part 6. Forgiveness. Forgiveness is one of the greatest quality. It comes when there is understanding, there is oneness, and this is one of the most important aspect. But by nature, both man and woman are jealous in nature. They want to hold love as a sole propriety, and they cannot tolerate in any way if any one of them falters in that. Then the question of forgiveness becomes very important. The purpose of the marriage, the male-female relation, is twofold. Number one, there is a commitment to the family cause on the part of both husband and wife. They are committed to this family cause, taking care of the family. But then there is another aspect of it, which is fulfillment at physical plane. Both man and woman seek fulfillment at the physical plane. When this does not happen and someone seeks it alternately, then we cannot accept that. I have heard a woman went to a lawyer and she said she wants to divorce her husband because he is too miserable and gives her problems. Divorce was filed and finally the divorce was accepted. A couple months after, when she went back to the lawyer and she said that I want to take back the divorce, the lawyer said, why you wanted to divorce your husband? She said, yes, I wanted, because all that problems that he gave me, I wanted him to be miserable. But after the divorce, I realized that he is happier. We cannot see each other's happiness. This particular aspect of the story that is part of Ramayana, the Hindu scripture, and used as an acid test by the sage Vishwamitra, who was testing Ram through these events. He goes to the hermitage of a sage that was an abundant place where there was a stone, a big piece of a stone. There he narrates this story. He said there was once upon a time a great sage called Gautam, and his wife was Ahilya. She was very beautiful, good looking, and the god of heavens, Indra, was passionately in love with her. Every morning sage Gautam in the early hours will go to the river and then to do his worship and then will return to the hermitage. So Indra saw this was the routine. So when sage Gautam had gone to the river, he disguised himself as sage Gautam and entered the cottage of Ahilya. He had an illicit relation with her. As he was finishing that and coming out of the cottage, sage Gautam returned. Seeing this, Indra got disturbed and Ahilya got worried, seeing two men the same way. Gautam recognized that it was the mischief of Indra through his mystical powers, removed the effect of that relation. And although he was a sage, man of awakening, understanding, but he was not able to forgive his wife for the involvement in this illicit relation. Although it was not her fault, she saw the man looking like her husband, and maybe her physical needs were not fulfilled, so she entered into that relationship. Sometimes this happens. We do not recognize the need of the other. Husband returns home, he is tired. The wife asks for the physical relation, and the man refuses to have the physical relation on the pretense that he is too tired. There is unfulfilled desire in the woman. Vice versa can also be the case. A woman is angry with her husband for some reason. and she refuses to enter into. This sensitivity requires that we need to understand each other's needs. This is the very purpose of this conjugal relation. And in that, when it continues for a long time, it may erupt into illicit relations. That is why in the past, marriages were arranged by the parents, and it was considered that woman was subservient to man. But now times have changed. Both are operating at equal plane. Woman is no more dependent on her husband for financial needs. In the past, it used to happen. Both are financially independent. If there is no financial independence, then it can be accepted. Women have no other choice but to accept the things like these from the husband. If the husband goes into an illicit relation to fulfill his physical needs, woman cannot forgive that. So too is the case of the man. The man cannot forgive that. Jealousy comes in. Why is she has to go into relation with someone else? This creates a great problem. In case of Muslims, their religion permits the marriages more than one. So it is an accepted norm that the husband has other wives as well. Whether it is accepted willingly or by force, it is accepted. But the forgiveness is very important. Sage Gautam could not forgive his wife for that act which according to him was extramarital or illicit. He curses her to become a stone. When woman or man's physical needs are not fulfilled, emotions are not understood, the person becomes a stone-like. So she remained as a stone for many years, for ages. And the place was abandoned. No one was living there. Sage Gautam had died. And when Ahilya pleaded to forgive her, it was said that when Vishnu will enter into an incarnation as Ram, and by his grace, she will attain to her physical form. Sage Vishwamitra narrates this incident to Ram. Ram looks at it and he shows his forgiveness. It is very difficult to forgive your own husband or wife, what to talk of others. If someone comes to you and narrates this similar incident, there is no way that you can forgive that person or give him the message of forgiveness. It happens that slowly and slowly, as one advances into physical aspect of the marriage, energy begins to wane. The energy moves in 7-year cycles. First 7 years is 0 sex. Then 7 to 14, you begin to be attracted towards the opposite sex. Then 14 to 21, 21 to 28, 28 to 35. By the time one attains the age of 40, sex should have been finished. It should have attained its fruition. The purpose of sex is to transcend the energy to the highest level, to move from where it is. And that is why one of the Swedish psychoanalysts, Carl Gustav Jung, said, "In 20 years of my medical practice, I have come to this conclusion. By the time one attains the age of 40, if the religion is given to the person, he or she can be healthy." It happens after the age of 40. The best friend of a male and a female is a person who has similar problems in life. In the beginning, when you are courting, your best friend is your spouse. And that time we do not even want to talk. We just simply hold hands, look into one another's eyes, and that communicates everything. As things proceed. We explore the physical body, then that does not remain in any way as an attraction. It is considered as a stereotype. Tantra mentions, emphasizes that each act should be act of fulfillment. It should be entered meditatively. Let me go into another story, and with that I will come back to complete this. During the time when Krishna was born, he lived in the place called Gokul on the bank of river Yamuna, the Blue River. The water of the Blue River was poisoned because a snake was living there. And people or animals, whosoever were drinking that water, were dying. No one was able to remove that. And it was said in that river lives a great serpent, and because of his poison, the river water is becoming poisonous and useless for human consumption. One day, Krishna conspired a game. He was playing a game of bowl with his friends, and he threw the bowl that belonged to another cowherd boy, and it went into the river. They started forcing Krishna to go and get the bowl. In the beginning, Krishna pretended that he will get another bowl. The boy said he wants his same bowl. When the matter could not be resolved, he jumped into the river and disappeared. He reached to the bottom of the river where the snake lived along with his wives. The snake was resting, and a fight broke between Krishna, the boy, and the snake king. In the beginning, it was difficult, and then finally Krishna was able to subdue the king, and thereafter the queens came begging for the life of her husband, the snake king. Krishna tells him that you have to leave this river and go elsewhere. Leave this river and go elsewhere. This is the story. The snake represents the kundalini energy, the energy of sex, which in human third body is found at the center of anus. It is stored there as sex energy. If it remains there, the negativities are born, nafs grows. This energy has to move from there and go to the other centers. From the sex center, it goes to the second, which is water center, which is located at the genitals. The center of excretion, that's where the energy is stored. From there it moves. So these two centers work in harmony with one another. This is the physical aspect of the marriage. Fulfillment, the energy has to move from the anus center or the muladhar. Mool means basic, adhar means the basis. From there it has to reach to the water center, and when it begins to overflow from there, it begins to reach to the other centers. When this happens meditatively, the couple attains to fulfillment at the physical level. From there, the energy moves to the third center, which is the center of life and death. In Japanese, it is known as hara, the center of solar plexus. This is the fire center. When you hammer this center through breathing, whether it is Allahu or any other, and hammering happens, the energy begins to move from there and go to the heart center. These two, the fire center and heart center together, the lower emotions sanctify and move to the heart center. This is the second aspect of the marriage, the emotional aspect. At the emotional level, the couple feels fulfilled. Physical fulfillment comes first, then emotional fulfillment, and with this the energy moves from nafs to kalb. Nafs kushi, it used to be said long time that in order to seek the spiritual path, you must suppress your nafs. Nafs kushi is the criteria for the awakening of the heart center. But the two centers have to balance into one another, the nafs and kalb. Then comes the throat center and the third eye center. This is the psychic centers. The throat center is the center of expression, and third eye is the center of order. According to yoga, it is known as the center of the psychic center. It is from this center the master instructs. It is from this center, if something is to be done and the message is to be sent, master allows his energy to reach to that center, and from there he instructs through the vocal cord or the fifth center, so the message is communicated. It is through this center all transformation happens. When you transcend the third aspect, where the fifth center, which is the throat center, and the third eye center become one, balanced, that is where the third aspect of marriage, the spiritual aspect of marriage, is fulfilled. Up to now, the center move in polarities. The first center, the Muladhara, and what the fire and the water center. In case of man, the Muladhara is masculine and water center is feminine, and opposite is the case of woman. It has to balance one another. The marriage attains fulfillment at the physical plane. So it is the responsibility of each of this couple, each person of that conjugal relation, to give the fulfillment at the physical plane to the other. You remember, if you are sensitive enough, you will understand the needs of the other, whether you are tired or not. If you are tired, you can find the way to bring the fulfillment to the other, rather than simply denying that I am too tired to enter into this physical act. Then comes the emotional maturity, emotional fulfillment. If marriage does not give you emotional fulfillment, it is incomplete. It is not a marriage in the sense that it is supposed to be the male-female relation.